Hello there, my name is Cameron and welcome to Road Dog Gaming, and today I'm doing something a little bit different that I don't typically do on this channel, but I keep constantly thinking about it and especially seeing videos by What Culture Wrestling, not plugging, but honestly go check out the channel, it's awesome, by What Culture Wrestling about how WWE should book things or how WWE should have booked things. I definitely wanted to do my own. So today is something that, well, something that I've thought could be done. Something I thought could be done very well within an area. You have to do it a certain way, but it can be done. Today is something I want to talk about, and it's something beautiful. Today what I'm talking about is how the Shield can make a return. Now, obviously, the Shield making a return is kind of something that's going to be hard to do no matter what you do, for the simple reason of the Shield is in such a state where they're not really good with each other. They all hate each other. They all want to kill each other at every moment. But I feel like they could definitely do it. They could definitely set this up in a perfect way and get it set to where the Shield comes back and is this big dominating force. So, starting off, the first thing that has to happen, so it's a one-on-one match. I'm gonna go in depth of how this can go. Let me turn down my volume just a little bit. Of how this can go from about nowish, about the next few months, to about a year, maybe two in the future. It depends on how much I can think of this for. I tried doing this video before and screwed up a lot, so I'm redoing it just to have the have it set up the way I want it to be. So first things first, how does it start? Well, it doesn't start on Raw, it doesn't start at a pay-per-view, it starts on SmackDown Live. Why on SmackDown? For the simple reason of, you have to make the smaller of the two shows have some impact, have some big thing that makes it start looking more popular and a better show and on the same depth as Raw. So, first things first, how does it start? Well, it starts like this. Dean Ambrose is in a one-on-one match. I'm not going to say who he's in a match with because it doesn't really matter because it's not going to last much very long. Now, Dean is getting very cheap-shotted, and it's not very fun for him. It's not a good match at the moment. He's being kind of screwed over for the match is what I'm trying to say. So then you hear Roman Reigns' music. And then you look up on the stage, but no one's there. Coming from the crowd, like they used to in their Shield days, is Roman Reigns and Seth Rollins. Now you can also do this with Seth's music playing. I really don't care. It's just the way I'm looking at it is with Roman's music, because I like Roman's music a little bit. I like Seth's music, but the way I'm seeing it is with Roman's music. So, obviously, they come out of the crowd, and you think they're going to immediately team with the other person, with the person facing Dean, but instead, the unthinkable happens. They start beating the ever-living fuck out of Dean's opponent. Like I said, doesn't matter who the opponent is, just it matters that they're a credible top card person. So, they start beating the crap out of the opponent, out of Dean's opponent, and it's a 3-on-1 handicap match now. It has changed very, very quickly from a 1-on-1 where Dean's being screwed over to a nice 3-on-1 handicap match with the Shield, not being called the Shield, just saying Roman, Dean, and Seth against the opponent. It's got to have some credibility, so maybe somebody that's going after the title would probably be the best option. So somebody like, I don't want to say John Cena, but John Cena. So, yeah, this is how it's going. Then the match pretty much ends with the Shield standing over him, and they're not in Shield attire. They're just in their normal, typical outfits right now for what they wear. It ends with them standing over John Cena, like big dogs, like they used to back when the Shield first started. Excuse me. And then you have no idea. This ends with Mauro saying, "Is the Shield back? What's going on? How's this gonna affect the WWE? And how's this gonna affect SmackDown and Raw and all this stuff?" And they're going insane. They have no idea what's gonna happen from this. Except, you kind of do. You kind of see it's going to be something amazing. Now, you don't know exactly what, but something. So then it goes into next week on Raw, where it's Michael Cole, Corey Graves, and who the fuck's the other Raw announcer? I forgot who the other Raw announcer is! Well, it's Corey and Michael and the other one whose name I can't think of. And Byron Saxon, that's why I couldn't think of his name, because it's fucking Byron Saxon. Talking about what happened last week on SmackDown, talking about the Shield quote-unquote return, whatever you want to call it. The Shield's revival, I don't fucking know. But it talks about that, and then they talk about the ramifications this is going to have. They talk about what's going to happen after this. So obviously, you don't know. You have some speculations. All the fans are wondering, is the Shield actually back? Why would Seth and Dean agree to be brought back into the Shield and all this? And next week, and then it ends. It ends with Roman standing in the middle of the ring after a match. It's a match against Seth. He versus Seth to make the whole, he versus Seth to make the whole Shield return kind of look fake. Like, it's not actually gonna happen, but you want it to happen. That sort of thing. So, you think it's not gonna really happen. You think, oh, they're not gonna actually bring the Shield back. What were we thinking? That's why they do this match. They do this match to throw you off. They do this match to make you think that's what's gonna happen, but you definitely still feel like the Shield's coming back. So after this, after that Raw, it's next SmackDown. And now, because of what happened on the previous SmackDown, the previous week, Dean is now in a 3-on-1 handicap match, although it won't stay that way for long, and I'm going to tell you why. So the match is Randy Orton and John Cena with some mystery opponent who hasn't been announced yet. You have no idea who's coming out to help John Cena. It's revealed to be none other than Rhino, because they need some sort of big guy. So Rhino comes out with John Cena and Randy Orton to face Dean Ambrose, Seth Rollins, Dean Ambrose. Then, out of nowhere, you hear the Shield music hit. Not Roman or Seth's, the Shield music. The legit music that played when the Shield was a tag team. You hear their music and you look out to the crowd. You see Roman and Seth making their way through the crowd yet again, like they did last week on SmackDown. You have Moro and everyone going nuts about it. You have Moro, JBL, and the other announcer, whose name I can't remember, and David Otunga. God, I'm forgetting names like crazy today. And David Otunga talking about, oh my God, is the Shield really coming back? And you notice, you look at Dean. Dean hasn't come out yet. Excuse me. You look at Seth and Roman, and they're in full Shield attire. They have the armor and everything back on. Now you look out to the crowd and you see a spotlight. You see them stopped, and they're from what it looks like. It looks like they're pulling some random fan out of the crowd, saying, "Hey, you want to talk or something like that?" But then you see none other than the Lunatic Fringe, Dean Ambrose. You see him being picked out of the crowd in his Shield attire, ready to battle. I say battle because it's the Shield, and yeah, it just fits. So you see him being pulled out of the crowd in his Shield attire, and everyone's like, where'd he come from? I didn't notice he was out here and all this. And all the fans are going crazy because they legitimately did not notice Dean Ambrose sitting in the crowd with them, especially not in full Shield attire. So they make their way down to the crowd, and it's seeming like it's going to be a pretty simple match. You know, it was seeming like they're just going to sit there. You know, they sit there, they sit at ringside, they make an announcement saying, don't worry, we're not going to interfere in the match or anything. We're going to sit here and we're going to watch this match. Now obviously that's not really what's going to happen because it's the Shield, but at the moment you think, okay, they're credible. You think this is what's just going to happen and they're going to join in if they absolutely need to. So it's just Dean in the match, and you think he's not gonna, he needs this help. He's not gonna get it though, because why would he? You don't think he does, he doesn't, no one thinks he deserves it. They're thinking it's Dean Ambrose. Why would he deserve to be helped by them? But then you don't understand what's gonna happen. You just watch as Dean is being dominated by all three of them, by Randy, Rhino, and John Cena. You just watch him get destroyed second after second in this match, and then all three of them go in. It's not just one of them, it's all three of them. All three of them join in, and this is when Roman and Seth say, this is enough, we need to help, we need to help him, and they join in. They hop in, they jump into the match, and they start helping Dean survive this match, more or less. You think, and then it's a nice tornado tag, triple threat, or 3-on-3, six-man tag match. It's Dean, Roman, and Seth, the Shield, the revived Shield, which is not what its name is going to be, but the Shield, nonetheless, versus the strange team of John Cena, Randy Orton, and Rhino. Why is that the team? I have no fucking clue, but it is. Did you see that? Xavier Woods knocked Kofi Kingston down. That was funny. They start going. They dominate. They continuously kick the shit out of the three of them until here comes the money. Money. Shane comes out with Daniel Bryan at his side. I don't know why they didn't use Daniel Bryan's music, but they didn't. They used Shane's for some reason. Why? Because that's the choice I made for them to use Shane's instead. But they come out and say, enough is enough. They've been taking this way too far. They stop the match by reason of, well, Randy, John, and Rhino can't really compete anymore. They just got the shit knocked out of them by the Shield. So, the match ends, and that's how SmackDown ends this week. That's how SmackDown ends, with the Shield standing over the bloody, mind you, the bloody bodies of Randy Orton, Rhino, and John Cena. I almost forgot who the fuck I said was in the match. But it ends with them standing over their bodies, their bloody bodies, because, yes, blood is allowed now. This is TV-14. They announced it's TV-14 again right after SummerSlam, right after the SummerSlam. Because remember, this does take place after SummerSlam. So, now, you have no idea what's going to happen. But for the next few weeks, the Shield is dominating both shows. They're not just dominating Raw, and they're not just dominating SmackDown. They're dominating Raw. They're destroying the entire Raw roster until you hear AJ Styles music hit and says, somebody needs to put a stop to this. You know, he comes out and cuts a vicious promo about how the Shield's destroying the WWE. They're invading each show, and people who don't belong on the show are on this show and all this. And you hear him say, but that person's not going to be me. And he reveals that he is now a surprise member of the Shield. Now, why? I don't know. But it just feels like, you know, it's a heel faction. They need a fourth member. You know what I mean? They need a fourth person to really amp up the Shield. So they add in AJ Styles. Now, he won't be here for long. I'm going to spoil that now. He's not going to be here permanently, but he will be here for a while. So for now, the Shield is AJ Styles, Roman Reigns, Seth Rollins, and Dean Ambrose. You have no idea where exactly this is going to go for, and instead of constantly saying their names, they're now going by Alpha, AJ Styles, Delta, Dean Ambrose, Romeo, Roman Reigns, and I think it's Sahara for S. I'm trying to remember the military alphabet. I can't exactly remember fully, but I believe it's Sahara or something along the lines of Sahara for S for Seth Rollins. And that's how they come out every week now. You hear Alpha, Delta, Romeo, Sahara, if it is Sahara, that is. And that's how, and then you hear Shield with all four of them talking. That's their new music. withstand boards like that. And now it's time for them to go after the gold. You have no idea who's going after what title, but seeing as how they're still on Raw, Roman and Seth decide to go after the tag titles, the Universal title, and the, well, okay, technically, they decide, as Roman still has the United States title after winning it at SummerSlam. I do have the prediction of him kind of winning it at SummerSlam over Ruru, no offense to Ruru, but just how I see it going. But you have them winning it at... him winning that at SummerSlam and continuing it on for a very, very long title run. And you have Seth going after the Universal title after losing to Finn Balor, aka the Demon King, at SummerSlam for the Universal title. So sadly, he doesn't get the honor of becoming the first Universal champion, but he does go after the title for a while. And yes, he does end up getting it with the Shield's help. Now Finn does not have the title. He loses it shortly after SummerSlam. He loses it at the Raw pay-per-view in September. Because I don't know what pay-per-view that is. He loses the title. I don't care who he loses it to. Just make it some like good top card guy. Maybe have it be Rusev. Maybe Rusev goes after the main title. That wouldn't be too bad of an idea. But have him go after the main title and win over Finn Balor, which kind of sucks for Finn because he doesn't really stand a chance against Rusev, even as the Demon King. But he ends up losing the title to Rusev. And you see Roman like, I beat you once, or you see Roman be like, I beat you once and Seth's going to beat you this time. The Universal title belongs to the Shield, as they already have the tag team titles over their shoulders after beating the club. Now over on SmackDown, we still have the World Heavyweight Champion, Dean Ambrose, after defending it successfully at both Backlash at SummerSlam to Dolph Ziggler and Backlash to Bray Wyatt, who ended up earning his title shot, with the newly crowned Intercontinental Champion, AJ Styles, after taking it off of not The Miz, but who's he versing at SummerSlam? The Miz loses at SummerSlam, pretty much. I can't remember who the fuck he's versing. I want to say Darren Young, but I'm pretty sure that's wrong. It's Apollo Crews, that's who it is. Apollo Crews. He loses it to Apollo Crews, and Apollo Crews ends up losing to AJ Styles, yet again, because of the help of the Shield. Now, during the Universal title match, however, it's a disqualification match. You can be disqualified, unlike the other matches that were mostly no DQ because of the match of who was facing the matches. Now, you didn't think of how it was going to go, but you kind of just knew. You knew something was going to happen. You knew the Shield was going to interfere somehow. During the match, the power goes out. Now, you think it's actual power outage or something like that, but no. The power outage was caused by none other than Roman Reigns and Dean Ambrose. I forgot this is for the Universal title. Roman and Dean cut the power to the arena. They pretty much just went to the breaker and shut all the stuff off. Excuse me. Now, you don't know what's going on, but you see, with a night vision camera, you see Dean Ambrose's face pop up, and he does those old Shield promos. You know the ones I'm talking about, where he grabs the camera, has it right on his face, and he's talking to the camera while he's entering the arena. He goes in, and no one else sees this. No one sees this. This is something you just hear the audio to, pretty much. But then you end up seeing the night vision camera as they go into the ring, and they demolish. They brutally demolish Rusev. They beat him to a pulp, pretty much to where he can't move. And it's going to be later revealed that Rusev is injured for about a month and a half because of a shoulder injury caused by this attack. And then when the lights go back on, when the lights finally get turned back on, you see Seth Rollins covering Rusev. 1, 2, 3 for the pin. And that's how the Shield takes over all of the main titles. They have the tag titles from both SmackDown and Raw, the Universal Championship, the World Heavyweight Champion, or the World Championship, World Heavyweight, whatever the fuck it's called nowadays. The Intercontinental Championship and the United States Championship, they own the WWE. But things start getting heated between AJ and Seth. This stints back to AJ thinking he deserves to be in the title, deserves a title match back at Battleground this year. This stems back to this. Seth and him are fighting the entire time, which is kind of good because, you know, they're on different shows anyway. But you never know what's going to come from this. So eventually, AJ, with the help, with none of the help of the Shield, surprisingly, nobody on the Shield actually does anything for this. AJ gets demolished by Seth at a pay-per-view at December. I believe December is Royal. No, not December. December's not Royal Rumble. Survivor Series, I believe, is sometime around this time, maybe November-ish, I think. But the next pay-per-view is Seth versus AJ, and if Seth loses, he loses his title and he's out of the Shield. Now, if AJ loses, same thing. But he doesn't. They don't lose the titles to each other. The titles just get vacated. That's it. The titles get vacated, and a tournament will be held for the titles, seeing as how the titles are on different shows, so they can't really be, you know, crossing shows. Seth wins, and AJ is kicked from the Shield and is stripped of his Intercontinental title. Now, this is the point in time when he reforms the club with Finn Balor. He reforms it with Finn Balor and has that be another dominant faction. Being the dominant, a dominant faction again, the Bullet Club, Balor Club, whatever the fuck you want to call it, the club, they're reformed, and it's AJ, Finn, Luke Gallows, and Carl Anderson. Now, at this point, it's kind of getting heated between everyone in the WWE locker room for the Shield. You still have Dean and AJ with the tag titles. Now, obviously, it's gotten to the point where you realize they're not going to keep them any longer. So, during their match at, what's December's pay-per-view? No, it's not going to be December. It's a tag match at Royal Rumble. That's what I'm going to make it. It's a tag match at Royal Rumble. I just fell. That was weird. A tag match at Royal Rumble. And, it kind of ends the similar way of how Titus O'Neil and Darren Young's Primetime Players reunion last night ended, where Titus kind of, you know, said, fuck you, I'm done, to Darren Young. But it pretty much ends that way. Excuse me, with Dean Ambrose hopping in the ring, hitting a dirty deeds on AJ Styles, and then the 1-2-3 pin from Chad Gable, because that's right. The tag titles for SmackDown are going to American Alpha. Why? Because American Alpha? That's fucking why, bitch. But they go to American Alpha. And, yeah. So that's how that ends up going. American Alpha gets the SmackDown tag titles off of them. Now, sorry, I was kind of focused on the match. AJ cuts a vicious promo after the match saying, that's bullshit, why the fuck would you do? Well, okay, he doesn't drop an F-bomb, but still. He says, why the hell would you do that to me? We were tag titles. Who cares what happened with the Shield? I deserve that championship, and you know I do. And all this stuff. He's bitching and moaning about how he just got screwed by his tag partner because of something that happened with the faction. And Dean pretty much hops up on the mic and says, well, brother, because he says brother a lot, you know. He says, well, brother, you've got your little club there. You've got your bald friends, your friends that look like a pair of testicles, stuff like that. Because they're saying testicles and shit on camera now because it's TV-14, mind you. And pretty much, he says, you've got the club now. You've got that Demon King friend of yours and the testicle of yours. Now, the club actually ends up turning on AJ right after this, too, which is a shock to AJ because he didn't expect it. But yeah, he gets turned on by the club and has essentially no one. Now, the Shield starts dominating more and more. And come WrestleMania, it's Seth and it's all of them competing for a new title. Now, what is this new title, you ask? Well, it's something that I kind of have always wanted to see in WWE, but have never really gotten, which kind of pisses me off. I remember I used to be able to make it in WWE versus in Raw versus SmackDown, because you can make a belt for three people. It's a three-man tag team belt, pretty much. And it's the Shield versus the Wyatt family. And at this point, the Shield and the Wyatt family are both on their own shows. The Shield are now all on SmackDown, and the Wyatts are now all on Raw. Now, Why exactly did Stephanie agree to it? Actually, no. I'm getting ahead of myself. Sorry about that one. I did this the last time I was making this video, too. Okay, so pretty much what happens is Dean gets screwed out of his title. First off, that's the first thing I should probably say is Dean got royally screwed out of his title at the pay-per-view before WrestleMania. I won the pay-per-views before WrestleMania, but ended up winning the Intercontinental title. Roman lost his United States title. Seth still has his Universal Championship, and they're all on Raw now. Wyatts are all now on SmackDown. With Braun Strowman being traded to SmackDown for Dean Ambrose, obviously. So, Roman lost his United States Championship, which now is over at SmackDown. He lost it during the Royal Rumble. And Dean lost his World Heavyweight Championship, but ended up getting the Intercontinental, which is now over on Raw. So, pretty much, it's them versus the Wyatts to decide who gets the three-man tag belt, what brand gets it first. Shield obviously wins, which is not a shocker to anybody. And by this point, we're up to that WrestleMania where the new draft is starting, and they're going as a tag team, obviously. So, the three of them get drafted to SmackDown. Why SmackDown? Because you need the belts. You pretty much just need the belts. That's the whole reason. Is you need the belts that SmackDown can get. So, they end up getting it. SmackDown ends up getting the belts. And it's, well, SmackDown gets the belts. While Raw gets a few belts, just not as many. But SmackDown gets the big belts that the Shield already had on them. And yeah, that's how it goes. SmackDown gets the belts that the Shield had on them before the draft. And well, god damn it, Roman run. And well, yeah, that's pretty much how it goes. So SmackDown has the belts, Raw has a few belts, just not the belts that they like. Stephanie and Mick are visibly pissed about this, but Shane and Dean feel pretty proud of themselves. They're like, hey, we've got not only the Universal Championship on our brand, but we also have the three-man tag belt on our brand, and we have the Intercontinental belt on our brand. Now, at this point, you're thinking, the Shield's so overpowered, why would they keep doing this, yada, yada, yada. And at this point, you don't know. No one knows. But the Shield is leading the WWE, and that's how it's supposed to be. It's how the Shield wants it. And they pretty much continue on as a dominant force for a while. Excuse me. Even claiming more belts again. Having the United States Championship, the Intercontinental, the Universal, the Triple Tag, and the Double Tag, which honestly, or not the Normal Tag, sorry, the Normal Tag is back on the New Day for, well, at least Raw's is. SmackDown's is still on American Alpha, because American Alpha did stay with SmackDown. But yeah, they have a lot. Excuse me. They have a lot of leeway with their titles. You know, they're dominating the WWE as they should be. But yeah, pretty much it ends at this wrestle after the draft. And I'm not going to book it any further than this for the simple reason of I'm not going to try. Because last time I booked it like 2 years in advance, 2 years further, and I just got kind of tired of how far I booked it. But pretty much, that is how I would rebook. I would book. This is how the Shield could still make their comeback. Is with how I've described it, and they could be a big dominant force again and leave open the room for new members and tons of stuff like that. New members and you know, tons of stuff. And, well, you know what? There's not really much else left to say. That's how it ends. The Shield dominating WrestleMania. And you know what? Yeah. But that's how it ends up going. The Shield dominates WrestleMania. They run the company pretty much like they used to.